Welcome everyone to another amazing episode of the Average Ontario Angler's Fishing Podcast. This is an actually super awesome episode because this is, what is it, the fifth? Fourth?
The fifth Q&A.
This is the fifth question and answer, which we often call, and I made this up, AOA Q&A, which is totally awesome. We actually asked a bunch of our Instagram followers and our Patreon members to send in questions for us to answer. And back by popular demand, it was never popular and it was never demanded, but we're back doing another AOA Q&A. But before we start with this episode, we are going to start with, as tradition states, an interesting fishing fact. And to handle that, the man with the beard and the mustache, Andrew.
So I'm going to be talking about two different fish. Thankfully, I'm going to prerequisite this by saying neither of these live in Ontario. And that's great. A big thing. Don't release fish that you have in tanks. Don't release anything that shouldn't be here. Invasive species can bring risks. Now, I want you to imagine, well, don't imagine, but at the end of this, think about what if these made it to Canadian freshwater? Terrifying. Okay. First one is the kandiru, also known as the toothpick fish. Does that ring a bell at all?
No, not at all.
Well, when you find out about it, it will. Oh. So these only grow a few inches long. They have a small head. They're very thin, like a toothpick. And after feeding, they can have like a big distended belly. And they're a parasitic fish. And they live in the Amazon. They have short barbels on their face, and they have short spines on their gill covers that point backwards. And they have been known to swim up the urethra.
Oh, I know exactly what you're talking about now.
We've all heard the horror stories, you know, in school. Everyone's like, did you know about the fish that swims up your urethra? Yes. Yes, I have. I don't know why I sounded like Hank Hill there, but yes. So reports of this happening has been around since the 1800s. Of these fish swimming up, you know, unsuspecting urethras since the 8th. However, the first documented case of successfully removing one from a urethra was in 19...
What? So there's like a huge amount of time where basically it just stayed up there forever?
No. So what happens is...
I don't want to know.
This is the fact, man. Forced extraction. Leads to lacerations, which have been known to cause death by exsanguination, which means severe blood loss. So just yanking on it is not the answer. It has been done and people have died. So tried and true, don't do it. Another popular method was to amputate.
Ah,
yes.
That doesn't even sound like a better option, really.
There is another one where they use like medicinal herbs to essentially soften the spines of that fish. And so then its removal is less painful and has less damage during removal. Doesn't eliminate, but less damage. Nowadays they can do surgery on it. Now, the best thing you can do is just wear tight swim shorts. So if you ever go to the Amazon, pack your banana hammock, your Speedos, all that stuff, and just make sure they're nice, tight. It's for safety, not for looks. So the second fish is called the pearl fish. So these live in salt water. They live in the ocean, which is good because the chances of them coming into our freshwater lakes is very slim. It's a good thing. Now I'm going to kind of go through and narrow the understanding of where they live. So they live in the ocean. They live in mainly tropical waters. They live in mainly shallow waters. They live in mainly sea cucumber butts. So they are also sometimes found in oysters or starfish, things like that. But primarily, they like to live in the butt of a sea cucumber.
Ah.
Now, sea cucumbers themselves are pretty interesting creatures. They actually breathe as well through their butts. So it's kind of like farting in reverse, but with fresh air. I'm not a scientist. But sometimes there can be up to 5 inside of a single sea cucumber. Now, some species of these pearlfish, they don't harm the host. They just live in it for shelter because they're a scaleless fish. They have like a long... Kind of like a burbot has like a long, like paddle-like body, right? So they're similar to that. They're long, slender. So a lot of them don't harm the host, at least physically. They don't harm him. I'm sure, you know, emotionally it's fairly scarring. But some other species of these fish will eat the gonads and other internal organs of the host. So thankfully, there are no reports of pearlfish attacking humans. But keep in mind, food for thought, before the 1800s, there were also no reports of the kandiru swimming into a urethra. So take it as it will. Let's just hope those statistics maintain plateaued.
You just basically reiterated the fact that I don't like going swimming. Every time Andrew's like, oh, let's go swimming. I'm like, why would I swim if I could fish? The only time I go swimming is if it's really hot. But if I was in those areas, knowing that something could enter my body, I'm going to take a risk and not go swimming. I'll just be hot. That's okay.
When you at told least here me that you just have to worry about snapping turtles. And it's they don't true. Try and enter you. They just try and like snap at you if they get really angry.
Yeah. But in both cases, something could be chopped off. So yeah. Let's be serious. It's equally as dangerous here in Canada as in the Amazon. Not equally, but it's still dangerous both ways.
Equally? I'm like, there's a lot of other weird fish in the Amazon.
It's true. Jeremy Wade made a career on it. Yeah. I don't see like Jeremy Wade in Ontario. Like, here I am in Ontario, the most dangerous land of fish. It's like, yeah, we have salmon. They have teeth. Sometimes in the fall. That was I want to say terrifying, not really interesting. Interestingly terrifying. I'll give you
that's
that.
What I aim for.
Yeah, actually, when I said to Andrew, he's like, yeah, I have an interesting fishing fact prepared. It's pretty much terrifying, or I forget what you said. You said it was disturbing, and I was like, oh, yeah, great. I'll have to edit that out. Just put a fun one on top of it. It's like, do you want to hear about fish bubbles? Yay. Just kidding. So that was interesting. Cool. I'm very disturbed. I like it. Okay.
You're welcome.
So you may notice if you're watching this on YouTube that I'm wearing a pair of waders. And the joke that I came up with this week is it's because we're going in depth with these questions.
That's right. Jesse put himself through torture to wear uncomfortable waders his entire podcast to just say that one lame joke.
Yes. And they're breathable. So they're actually not uncomfortable.
I love the crinkling noise. I really hope you can hear that on the recording.
Ready?
Yeah.
They're crinkly. So anyway, so for this Q&A, we actually asked our followers on Patreon and Instagram, and I said, ask us anything fishing related, because usually if you don't say fishing related, you obviously get some weird questions that we can't answer. So I always put appropriate fishing related questions, and you guys did not disappoint. We have over 50 questions. That's amazing. So we're going to try to get through as many as we can, and as we always try, we're going to keep it short to a minute per question. Will we succeed? No. Have we ever succeeded? No. So here we go. I'm going to pick the questions that, and either answer them myself or let Andrew answer them based on who I think would do a better question, job answering that particular question. So we're going to start right at the top. This is our first question from Mitch Fishes. He says, what modifications or additions have you made to your sports pal? So this is actually...
I'll field this one, Jesse.
Yeah, yeah. I'll answer it because I have a sports pal. This is actually a question that I get asked all the time because I don't want to sound like I work for sports pal, but I 100% have sold guaranteed 10 of those things to people that I've recommended them to. I've had people be like, I bought this because of you. And they send me a picture of like a beautiful red sports pal, like on an Algonquin lake. I'm like, nice. I was like, I want some commission off that. But anyway.
Yeah, we've yet to receive the check from SportsPal.
Yeah, but I wish. But anyway, if you're listening to this and you work at SportsPal, please send me a check too. Hey, wait, just kidding. But anyway, I have made a lot of modifications. A lot of people have asked me. There's some videos on YouTube with guys that have done a lot of, you know, modifications themselves. We're really hoping. I know I've been putting it off, but this year we're actually going to do that video because we've done a lot of stuff. So I'll name a few of the very brief modifications I've done. For one, I added a power pole. A manual power pole on the back, like a shallow water anchor, just like a spike. And I added basically a block of cutting board material with a hole exactly the same diameter, slightly bigger, but it's pretty hard to get down so that I can anchor in shallow water when I'm bass fishing. I love that because oftentimes we're fishing in lily pads or, you know, shallow areas where if it's windy, you can just jam that pole down and you're stuck there. And I've had it in pretty good wind where it's pretty good chop and the boat is just rock solid. Now you can get the automatic, like I think the power pole micro, as they call them, that you just press a button and it goes, yee, goes up and down. They're like $800. So I made one myself. That's a manual one. And all I had to do was buy the pole. So it actually only cost me like $100 instead of $800. So that's one modification that I really enjoy. And I have a flat back, so it goes right on the back. The second modification that we made is on the seats are like web seats, and on the side, they're just openings. So one thing that we did is we put plywood underneath each section so that we actually have like an area to put our cup of coffee or baits, stuff like that. That extra little bit of storage, it doesn't sound like a lot, but it's a huge deal. Anywhere in a small boat where you can add storage, huge deal. Andrew will tell you with his tinner, like any little space, you need to put something in it. And then
the best modification for you've made was those rods that went across that you can mount your Scotty mounts to.
Yeah.
So because those are really versatile.
If you've ever seen a sports paddle, the canoe, it has bars that go across to keep it rigid. But unfortunately, those bars are actually pretty thick. So if you buy any like Scotty mount or any other brand mount, they're actually too fat to go on the rail mount. So what I did is I had a piece at work of, I think it was 3/4 EMT, like electrical conduit. And I cut it and I actually bolted those on so that I could mount rail mounts onto that. And I have everything hooked on that. Like Andrew said, I have my fish finder, I have my trolling rod holders, everything's on that. It makes it super easy. Super tough. You don't have to worry about the mount breaking off or clamping onto the side. I've actually got one at the back near me, and I have one at the front, which actually doubles as an extra handle that Andrew uses as well. So that we made tons of modifications, but we're going to do a whole video. So stay tuned for that. So here's a good question for Andrew. Southern Ontario Angling. He says, I can't stop thinking about topwater season. What is your absolute favorite topwater bait?
Recently, anything walk the dog, I really like. But I had to say recently, I've gotten into the Hellraiser, which is, they claim it's like a walk the dog style bait. It's really, it's a cast retrieve bait. It does all the action for you. Super easy to use. But I've had lots of good success with it last year, and I'm excited because they just brought out the 4 1/4 inch one. I think it's 4 1/4, but it's just like slightly smaller size, which I'm really hoping will slay for smallmouth this year. So I really like those because I had good success last year, and it's kind of a new lure, so I'm looking forward to seeing what else I can do with it this year.
And that's Z-Man.
That's the Z-Man Hellraiser.
Yeah, so to describe it, if you've never seen it, they're actually pretty unique. It's like pencil kind of
bait.
But it's got like a chatterbait blade on the back that's weighted down like with two balls.
Yeah, it has a different size treble, so it has a smaller treble on the back right behind that weighted blade. And then there's a larger treble right between that blade at the bottom. And the line tie. The line tie, like where you attach your swivel or whatever to, is actually like a third of the way down from the nose. Like it's not at all at the top. So when you attach it to that lure, like you're attaching it here, and the whole thing's just like shaking back and forth as it like cups through the water.
Yeah.
So it's the action, I would say, is similar to like a jitterbug in kind of the bubble trail and stuff that it leaves. Except you can fish these things like really faster. Fast. You can fish them even still fairly slow, like not as slow because they don't float themselves. They have to be retrieved to stay on top of the water. But because they're so heavy, they cast like super accurately. They always cast tail end first because of that heavy weight. It's like you can fire these things longer than, you know, a good jerk bait. Like it's insane.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'd say like, if I had to describe it, it's like a Zara Spook and a chatterbait had a baby. It's like a floating chatterbait. It's super cool. And in fact, Andrew caught the biggest muskie last year of our muskie trip we went on the Hellraiser. So
yeah, I upgraded the hooks and it still like stayed with muskie grade hooks.
Yeah. Yeah. Here's another question from MG Mitch. He says, have you ever been on any guided fishing trips? So I have. I've been on actually only one, and I went fishing with Bobby Belmonte, B2 guided service or 2B guided service. It was a fantastic day. I went with my buddy Paul and we went out muskie fishing. I've always wanted to go for a guide. I'm always like hesitant because it is a lot of money, but I'll tell you, if you can actually save up 1 year and go once, like it is a lot of money. It is. But to be able to fish, it's nice to be able to fish in like a nice boat. Like I was in a bass boat. It was nice. We're flying down the lake and you're going fishing with someone that literally fishes all the time. Like you may think you fish a lot, but guides oftentimes fish literally every day. Like they're out there. They know, oh, it's cloudy. These fish are going to be here. This, like, especially if they're on their home lake, like there's a bunch of lakes that they fish all the time. Like Bobby was calling fish. He's like, there's a muskie here, guaranteed. I checked out a tube jig. 2 minutes later, I had a muskie in the net. I was like, what? Like, he knows where they are. Like, he guides, a lot of guides do different species, but Bobby was just like, yeah, musky, walleye, crappy, pike, smallmouth, whatever you want. He'll know where to catch them because he's out there all the time. And he's a hammer. Like, he's a good angler. And there's a lot of guides out there that are similar. They're really good at fishing. That's why they're guides. Obviously, a guide wouldn't be very popular if you went out fishing and didn't catch any fish. So a lot of these guides, like, they're really experienced and they know where the fish are. That's their job, is to get you on fish. But the cool thing about being with a guide, and you've probably, if you've never been with a guide, similar to being guided by a more experienced angler, maybe not you're paying for a guide, but if you ever go fishing with someone that's experienced and you learn a lot from that person. Like, I've gone fishing steelhead with guys that are just hammers for the day. It's like, oh, let's meet up, we'll go fishing, and they destroy me, but I'm watching what they're doing and I pick up all these little tips, and they're happy to show, oh, look, this is what I'm doing, I have this thing on, and oh, your float's a little bit too low. You pick up little tips that save you so much trial and error, right? So you go with a guide, and it's not just about catching fish. Like, catching fish is great. Like, obviously you'd want to catch fish when you're with a guide, but at the same time, it's the learning. You're learning so much. They're, you know, compacting all of this, like, weeks, months, years of knowledge, and they're just like, okay, I'm going to get you on fish using this experience, and you can pick up so much information from learning from these guides. So again, they are expensive. It's not cheap. Like, it may, you know, you may be able to go once a year, you may be able to go five times a year, but I definitely recommend it, especially if you want to learn a lake or learn how to catch a specific species. Like, if you're like, oh man, I've had a hard time catching crappie, I just don't know where to go, hire a guide one day. You'll learn more in that one day than you will for the next 5 years trying to figure it out yourself. I guarantee it. Unless you're like a legit hammer and you're just like, oh, figure it out myself. But I would recommend it for sure. And you know what? It's expensive. Split it with a buddy. A lot of these guys will take two of you out. You split it in half, it's not that bad.
Yeah. Jesse and I are actually looking forward to doing a guided trip, hopefully this year.
Yeah.
Trying to get that working out. But hopefully, I've never been with one yet, but hopefully that'll change in a few months though.
Every time I take Andrew fishing, it's a guided trip.
And how can we keep learning about finesse techniques from me?
It's true. Here's a good question from Jeff. He says, what's a lure either of you have had success with that other people typically don't? That's a good question.
Well, oddly enough, I've heard from a few people that chatterbaits, oh, you guys always say chatterbaits work. And then, like, I know it's not majority of people, but I don't understand why some people just can't.
Yeah, we do get a lot of people that say they don't catch anything on chatterbaits. And I'm like, how? What are you doing? Like, I've taught literally my 8-year-old cousin or nephew just to, you know, cast us out, reeled in. Boom, 2-pound bass grabs it. Like, I don't get how people can't catch them. Like, I don't know. Maybe it's just that lake, but they're great lures. It's hard to beat. I don't know. Like, that's a hard question because we do use a lot of baits, but we tend to stick to baits that are generally popular for a reason, you know? But I don't know. What else? Any other?
Like, I fish baits that aren't popular, but I don't think, I've never heard, you know, it's not like, oh, guys, they never catch on, you know, this spoon or whatever, but I do well with it. You know, if you talk about a spinner, a lot of guys don't use spinners, but I do really well in it. But that doesn't mean that, you know, if more guys fished them, they do well in them too.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm not really, really sure. If I had to choose anything, maybe the Williams Wobbler. Like, I do well with that, and I don't see many people use them.
Sure. Yeah. I think that's a lot of the case with a lot of lures. It's like, sometimes, you know, you like the lures that say you grew up fishing with your dad, and your dad had, oh, my dad likes jitterbugs. And then the other guy's like, oh, my dad likes hula poppers, and they're better. It's like, they're not better. It's different, and that's what you like and you have confidence in, and it's nostalgic. So, like, people, they choose lures for different reasons. And it's funny how some people think, oh, those lures don't work, or that color doesn't work. And then other people fishing the same lake be like, oh, that color's my favorite, I catch all my fish on that. So it just goes down to show you that, generally speaking, as long as you're not doing anything crazy, confidence is everything. If you have confidence when you're fishing, you'll catch more fish, guaranteed. Here's a really good question from Thornburn the Fifth. He says, what is your favorite time to wake up for a day of fishing?
10 o'clock. Is that the best time to wake up for a day of fishing? No, but it's my favorite because I didn't have to wake up early.
Yeah. I'll tell you that time has changed as I've gotten older. When I was in my 20s, especially my early 20s or teenager, I don't care. I'd get up at 4 a.m. every day. Who cares? Now it's just like, when we go camping, oftentimes, say we go on a 3-day trip, we'll have like, okay, one day we're going to get up at the crack of dawn and we'll go fishing. And then the next day I'm like, let's sleep in and fish, like, you know, we'll fish after lunch. all the way till it's pitch dark outside. And we'll sleep in till like 9 or 10 o'clock. Everyone's like, oh, you're wasting your camping. It's like, dude, this is my vacation. I have to relax. I work every day. Like, every day I want to actually have a nap, you know? So I'd say there's something really nice about waking up at the crack of dawn. Like, it's special, you know? Like, I always remember my dad, we go bass fishing and he'd be like, or trout fishing early in the morning. He'd be like, okay, we got to be there at 5 a.m. So we'd have to wake up at 4 a.m. and drive there, and it's still pitch dark out. And just this, you know, the sky just slowly gets a little bit lighter, and it's like, you can't fish yet because you can't see. And it's just, it's exciting. And I know a lot of people love that. I love it too, but I also love sleeping. So I don't know.
I really, really like, I would say my favorite time to get up for fishing is if I'm camping or if I'm at the cottage and I'm on the water. I really like waking up before sunrise when it's really foggy on the water. I love casting like top waters, fishing like a spook or something like that. And just it being completely quiet, like all the songbirds aren't out yet. You hear the loon only. Like, it's the only thing that's making noise. You might hear the odd frog or something like that, but it's generally very quiet. And if there's roads nearby, there's not a lot of traffic yet. And, you know, I'll fish the whole time until the sun burns off the fog. Like, that's, to me, that is, I don't get to do that when I'm, you know, have to drive up to the lake, because I rarely get there on time because I have to get up, you know, at 3 o'clock if I've got to drive up there.
Yeah.
But if I'm on vacation and I'm on the water, that's something that I can do. So that's special for me. So I'd say that's my favorite time.
Yeah. Something special about the morning, just especially that mist coming off the water. Oh.
And I'm not going to say that's my best productive time, my most productive time, because it's not. Usually for me, that's
like evening.
Evening, even some, depending where I am, midday.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
It's so weird, but morning is usually not the most productive for me on a lot of lakes, but it is my favorite.
Yeah. And I think too, it depends what you're targeting. Like, just to go slightly off topic, like for instance, if I'm going to fish frogs on the lake pads in the middle of the summer in like August, that early morning, it's not as good as you think it is. Like, those bass, when the water's low, they're roaming around feeding. And when that sun comes up, they all go underneath the lily pads. So they're more concentrated underneath the lily pads. And like, I will catch just as many fish, you know, like 1 o'clock in the afternoon than I will if I wake up at like 5 a.m. I find where I fish anyway. So sometimes you just have to decide to either sleep in and take a nap and fish later in the day, or just be crazy and fish the whole day. Nothing wrong with that. If you have a wife and kids though, that may not work. Here is a cool question from some guy whose name I can't pronounce. He said, what is your favorite way to catch bass?
3, 2, 1.
Frogs. Yeah. Frogs are probably the funnest way to catch bass. It's like just fishing lily pads, even like not lily pads, just like skipping frogs under, you know, like overhanging trees and bushes along the shorelines, and it just hits the water. And as soon as it hits the water, it's like, boom, they're on it. It's like, oh, I love that. Just like catches you off guard.
Like, I love frogs, because a lot of time if I'm going for bass, it's largemouth. But if there's mainly a smallmouth lake, poppers. Like, I like walking the dog, but like popper, we can walk the dog too. But again, it's a nice concentrated area that you're targeting. I love catching bass on a popper.
Yeah. One of my favorite topwaters ever is like a prop bait. And one of the ones that I've done very well on is the Rapala skitter prop, I think it's called. Mm-hmm. Or no, the long one, the X-Rap prop. It's like a long, almost like a devil's horse. Propeller on both, like front and the back. And the way that I found the old timers fish is you just cast it out, you let it hit the water. But all the rings dissipate till it's just sitting there. And they're always like, imagine a fish is staring at it. Because like, if there's a fish there, I guarantee it's looking up. As soon as that thing hits the water, it knows its surroundings very well. And then the first, you just pull the rod slightly and it's like the little like propellers are like, and it just spits a little bit of water. Just very gentle, like pull it, not even jerk it, and let it sit there. And the second time you pull it and a bass just comes up and boom, just smokes it like that. I think it's just the waiting. It's like just calm water, and all of a sudden this fish comes out an hour and blows up. It's like, oh my goodness. So many times.
I love the old wounded spook. It was like the size of a Zara spook or a spook junior, but it had a prop on the front and back.
Yeah, another great bait. But if it wasn't a topwater, I think almost every bass angler is going to be like, yeah, topwater. But I love just chucking a one in a chatterbait, like we said. Like, give me a chatterbait, a 3/4 ounce chatterbait with a whatever trailer, green pumpkin. I can just go down the bank, either on from shore or in a boat, just go down the bank and just target cast it underneath docks, underneath, you know, overhanging trees, along weed lines. Doesn't matter. Rip it through weeds. along rocks. It doesn't matter. I'll just keep going. Do, 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 do. And when the fish grab it, it's just like they try to kill the thing. It's always just like an arm jarring strike when they hit a chatterbait. It's not like they're just like, eh. They're like, ah, they try to kill it. I honestly think bass don't like chatterbaits. I think they actually hate them. I think that's what happens. They hate them. They try to kill them.
I also really like a finesse press. Like I love BFS, but really like natural finesse presentations. And in my mind, it's you know, fooling the fish into thinking it just ate like a regular little morsel of food. And be like, psych, like set the hook on this absolute monster fish.
Yeah, psych. Here's a good question from Ted, who is actually the guy who composed and played all the instruments for our intro, which is super awesome. Thanks again for that, Ted. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Every time I listen to that, I'm like, yeah. Sick. But here's this question. He says, have you ever been bitten by a species of fish with teeth? If so, how bad was the damage?
My boat still has bloodstains from Jesse.
Yeah, I know.
Every time we go pike fishing, he's gotten better over the years, but especially in years past, like the cottage tinner, I'm pretty sure those seats have like blood yeah. spots on them, because Jesse would insist on unhooking his pike just with his fingers all the time.
Which is totally fine, but they always, the pike last minute would shake its head.
They're like snot rockets. All of them are like 22 inches.
Yeah.
And it was just like full of energy.
Yeah. I've learned, I was young and dumb back then, but yeah, pike, I don't know if necessarily like, has a fish bit me? No. Have I got nicked by their teeth? Yes. Almost every muskie I catch in some capacity, like say you're like grabbing a muskie and it starts shaking around, guaranteed you're going to cut your hand inside. Guaranteed. Like you see all the posts of guys catching muskie and it shows their hand after and it's like all bloody. Yeah, it's going to happen. Are there ways to get around that? Sure. Are we going to do them? No. It's a sign of honor having all that blood on Andrew's boat. But yeah, probably just pike and muskie. Although I did get nipped pretty good by a walleye once. And again, I was being dumb. I didn't have pliers on me. I just grabbed like a bait and a rod. I went down to this lake I was fishing in Ottawa and I just chucked out a chatterbait. Boom, boom, boom. Smoked a good one. It was like 26 inch. Came up and it had the chatterbait choked. And I was like, ah, oh, I don't have pliers. So dumb. And I was trying to like reach down and it literally just like, I got nipped by, they have pretty sharp teeth.
Oh,
that was
they're
a,
not
a
blades,
gusher too.
But they're super yeah. sharp. Yeah. I it wasn't teeth, but I guess the fish I ever received the most damage from was a bullhead catfish. I mean, like it speared me pretty good in the side of the hand grabbing it.
Oh yeah.
It flipped
with the spine.
And yeah, like they bleed forever after.
Oh,
it always looks worse than it is.
So here's the next question from Jeff. He says, tips or anything he should know for Algonquin fishing trips. I'll just be by myself with my kayak.
Let people know where you are. That's a good tip.
That's a good tip. Anytime you're fishing by yourself, but especially like backcountry, always let someone know where you are, when you're expected back. That's not a fishing tip, but that's just a safety tip. Because
I figured I mentioned that.
We're not like Algonquin experts, but Andrew's been going there his whole life. I've been going there a few years now. It's very quickly, easily, it doesn't take long to get past where you have absolutely no cell phone service at all. And you're past the area where maybe someone won't even go by you all day. You know, you could be on like even not even a back lake where you don't see anyone for days. So you could literally get into a bad situation. And if you don't have a way to communicate with someone, you're in trouble if you're by yourself. So my tip would be, for those lakes, we have had really good success fishing for bass in Algonquin. I know there's tons of other species. There's, you know, trout, brook trout, lake trout, walleye, there's bass. One tip that we found is everyone targets the smallmouth. Don't sleep on the largemouth. Some of the lakes have really good largemouth in them. Me and Andrew have caught some of our biggest largemouth in Algonquin Park. And they're in spots you'd never expect. You're like, oh, it's just like a tree. Oh, boom. Huge bucket, and everyone's like, oh, I've never seen one of those in here. It's like, well, the last 5 years we've been here, all of our biggest bass have been largemouth, so they're obviously in there, and they're just in areas that people aren't targeting.
Yeah,
you know, a lot
looking of for those like deeper rocks and whatnot, yeah. And like, oh, look at that shallow bay with a log in it, like,
yeah,
you pull like, a 3-pound largemouth.
Remember that one you caught on the Savage Gear snake? That bay was like 2 feet deep.
Water.
Yeah, and I was like, you know what, this is too shallow. I don't think there's anything in here. And Andrew's like, no, I want to go by that log. And he chucked out his snake and boom, this big largemouth came up and smoked it. So don't ignore the largemouth if you're going up. Not saying you can't fish for smallmouth. There's some really good smallmouth fishing in there. But if you want to have some fun a day, go pitch jigs around some of the sunken trees along the shoreline, especially like with access to some of the deeper water. You'd be surprised the size of the largemouth in there.
The tip I would say is just to, again, give more my own two cents on that, would be think classic. Like, for your baits, spinners, spoons, you know, just a ball head jig and a twister tail has caught me even in recent times. And I've fished, you know, others I've fished, like topwaters. Topwaters are great, but you can go a classic spook and still nail fish on it. And I think I've caught majority of my fish on more classic baits and presentations than, you know, something that's more like jerk baits and stuff like that. Will they work? Absolutely. But I feel like I would have more confidence in the Algonquin lakes and really tannic water and whatnot with, you know, a MEP spinner. I know numbers wise, I'll be getting way more fish in the boat.
Yeah. You can go, a lot of these lakes don't have a lot of pressure. So just keep it simple and have fun. Like Andrew said, a ball head jig, we slay on those up there. Or like a MEP spinner, a spoon. Like, you don't need anything crazy, but hey, it's also like, if you like experimenting, try whatever you want because you'll catch fish, but you don't have to go crazy.
I fished the Savage Gear snake and pulled it a good bass. So you can use whatever you want. You can get success. But yeah, the classics still work in those lakes.
Yeah. Here's a question from I Catch Dinks, which is true. I checked his Instagram account. He said, which boat do you guys prefer to fish out of? The Tinner or the Sports Pal, and why? Both. It's, if we have a limited amount of time, we love using Andrew's Tinner because it goes 40 kilometers an hour. That's great when you're trying to get from spot to spot. Like, well, we have a few lakes that we hit. And if we only have like 6 hours to fish and we have to drive there and back, you know, we only have 5 hours to fish. It's like, okay, we have this spot and this spot and this spot we want to hit. If we're going in my Sports Pal that only goes 10 kilometers an hour, we would waste so much time just getting from spot to spot. But in Andrew's boat, it's literally like a rocket. It goes 40 kilometers an hour and it's a 14 foot tenor. It's like, boom. Like, we can shoot from one spot, fish it for 10 minutes. Nope, nothing here. Shoot to the next spot. We can shoot across the whole lake if we want in like 10 minutes. My boat would take hours. So I do like that. I like the stability too of the tenor.
Mm-hmm. But I'm biased. Like, given if you were to fish a lake that we could access with either my tenor or the canoe, we usually take the tenor. Because why wouldn't you if we can launch the boat there? Yeah, but there's a lot of places where it's, again, partly because I tow my Tinner with a car, an Elantra. So I can't use a lot. Like, if it's a dirt ramp, usually I can't use it. So there's a lot of places where we're limited in our access. So we can't even bring the Tinner on that lake. So we use the Sports Pal. But at the same time, that gives us a fishing surface that we can, you know, generally both still stand up on most days. You know, unless the weather's like fairly bad, pretty windy. So we can still both fish effectively with the Sports Pal, and then we can hit these like back lakes that,
yeah,
big boats aren't in. And I love that too. So it's more of, depending on the lake I'm going to, if I can get my boat on it, I will. If we can, if it won't, we're going to use a Sports Pal because it's going to be a good lake anyways.
Yeah. And I'll tell you, there's something nice about being in a small boat, like you said. Even if you're fishing a lake that you can get a bigger boat on, because there's areas of the lake you might not be able to get into. Mm-hmm. Like, we fish this one lake and it's full of stumps. And guys in their big boats are like, I don't go in there because I don't want to hit my boat on a stump because they're everywhere. Like, my Sports Pal has so many dents in the bottom of it. I don't care. I'll drive into stumps. I don't care. But my boat literally floats like, I think it can float in like 4 inches of water. Like, it's insane.
I think,
like,
mine's only 6 inch draw too, which is sweet.
We can literally push anywhere. And the Sports Pal is so light. I get so many questions about it. It weighs 55 pounds. And the motor is a 2.5 horse. So it's not fast, but I picked it because it's light. It weighs 29 pounds. So with that and a battery, you're not much over 100 pounds, 120 pounds for the whole rig. You bring two rods and a tackle box and, you know, your orange pail like you need, right? And you're set. You can literally put that anywhere you want. We've put that, again, we've portaged it over beaver dams. We've slid it down hills. We've put it along the railroad tracks. Like, we've had that thing everywhere. And this is the fourth season that we're going to have been using it. And I'm almost guaranteed that we're pushing up probably 75 to 80 days on the water on that thing. It's pretty insane. It did help though that the first year I got it, I was laid off all summer and I went out fishing almost every day. But yeah, like, we put a lot of use on that. But I would have to say one thing: if you are looking to get a Sports Pal or a small craft, and you don't have the ability to tow a boat, say you have a small car. Andrew's a small car, but he has somewhere he can park his boat. which happens to be my parents' house, but he has somewhere to store a boat. He can tow it.
Thanks again, guys.
Yeah, they're not listening. But if you don't have the ability to store a boat, or you don't want to have a motor, a big motor and all that stuff, a sports paddle is great because you can store that anywhere. You can flip it upside down in your backyard. You can literally get away with a small motor, even a trolling motor on the back, but you can still scoot around. And it fits on the top of your car. I get so many people ask me, like, how do you transport that on a trailer? Like, no, it weighs 55 pounds. I can pick it up myself, no problem. Slap it on my roof racks, which are rated for 300 pounds. It's fine. Strap that thing down. It's not coming off. You don't have to worry about it. So it's a great option. But again, I always want to fish in the biggest boat possible if I can get away with it, because it's super fun.
Mm-hmm.
And speed is fun too. Not the drug, but driving the boat. I wouldn't know. Here's a question from Jeff. He says, any big fishing trips planned for the summer? We were actually just talking about that before the podcast.
Mm-hmm.
We have a pretty cool year planned out so far. You want me to go through? Because I know I plan most of them. So I'll tell you which ones Andrew's going. So our first big trip, it's not really a big trip, but it's big for us because it's the first day we get out in Andrew's boat. And we're going to go out in probably about next week by the time this comes out. We're going to go out for our first rip for pike. Now, pike is open in April in the Kawartha Lake area, or zone 17. It's one of our main areas that we fish. So we're going to go for a rip for pike. And Andrew will tell you, like, we love that first rip of the year. You know, it's so fun.
You get your lungs filled with that two-stroke smoke.
Oh, yeah.
That's beautiful.
Yeah. It's always, like, so nice. The first, like, when he launches into the boat, into the river. And then he just starts pulling the cord, and after two pulls, like, and we're just like, oh yeah, it's so good.
And every single time I crack that throttle, maybe a third of the way, it's like, yeah. And then all of a sudden, I just like max it out. And, yeah.
Yeah. And we're both like, oh, we get pushed back in our seats. Like, this is the force of like 3 G's right now.
It's,
when you're in the sports
really cool.
call, yeah. And then you sit in Andrew's boat after, it's like being in a race car.
It's cool. I really like doing our early like spring pike. Especially because it is open year round, so you can get in like really early for pike there, and that's kind of our first trips that we do, because then your chance of, you know, you hook into these good size fish, and it really kind of helps you shake off like the winter blues.
Yeah,
and you'll be back in the water doing that, and then shortly after we're going to be doing some crappie fishing again, which I'm really excited about.
Yeah, pretty much like April, a lot of people are fishing crappie, and we find for pike, no one really targets them. Like, there are people that do, but not a lot. Sometimes we'll be out on the lake, like one guy fishing, that's it, which is great. Crappie fishing can get pretty crowded, especially in April when, you know, when the water temps, you know, start going up 50, 60 degrees, and then the crappie all kind of storm into the shallows to spawn. They can get, you know, when the word gets out that they're in those bays, you can see tons of boats out there, but you can still have a good day and catch them. But for us, it's like we go for pike because no one targets them, and you can catch. We've seen some absolute giants, and like so far, like last month, we caught that really nice one. So like, there's opportunities in Ontario, even in the city. Guys down in Toronto catch big ones right from shore, big ones, 40 inches, no problem. You know, not all the time, but it happens. So like, you can catch big fish from shore, pike in April before the water gets warm and they head back deep. These big females are still hanging around even in April. So definitely check that out. But make sure you check your regs, like we said, because only zone 17 is open in April. Like, that's the zone I know that's open. There may be other zones open, but a lot of the other zones, pike doesn't open until the second week of May or the first week of May.
And that's so Ontario. So depending where you live in the States or whatnot, who knows what your local regs are.
Yeah. And then after that, we actually have a pretty fun trip planned with a walleye guy. He is an absolute walleye hammer, and he's taking us out in his boat. We're excited about that. We're actually going to film some content with him too, because he's a local hammer. We're really excited about that trip. After that, we actually have a camping trip with paddleheads, so we're going walleye fishing as well. We're going on a backcountry walleye trip again. We did it, was it last year?
Last year.
Yeah. We did it last year, and man, it was absolutely fantastic. Those guys, definitely check them out on Instagram too. Paddleheads, they do like, basically, they call it adventure fishing, right? So they go into the wilderness, but they fish. So it's more of the extreme of what we try to do. Like, we're like, oh yeah, we go backcountry. They're like, yeah, we do that all the time. So definitely check them out. I'll put a link down below in the show notes. You can check out their YouTube channel, because we're in one of them. I think definitely are. I think he got some pretty cool drone footage of us. Very cool.
Yeah.
After that, we actually have our our regular bass opener trip. Me and Andrew always go out on bass opener and we go camping. This year we're actually trying a brand new lake. We're really excited about. Andrew's done a lot of research about it. It's a lake that we both have a really good feeling about, I think. Like, I think there's a giant in there. Maybe two.
I think so too.
Yeah. But Andrew will have front boat advantage, so he'll catch both of them. It's fine. After that, we actually are going to go muskie fishing because muskie season will be open. We don't really have a big trip early in the season for muskie. Usually we wait till like September, October to do a big muskie trip. And then in the summer, Andrew's going up to his cottage for a full week, I think you said.
Yep.
So he's going to try to catch
a couple friends and
the big kahuna.
Oh yeah. Got to go for that one again.
Yeah. And then after that, I actually have a camp. I have a few Algonquin trips that are pretty much in a row around the same time. Andrew's not coming to one of them because he's busy. And then we're actually doing a muskie trip. Just me and my wife, we're actually, it's our 10-year anniversary. So she booked us a cottage on a little lake that is known to have the odd muskie in it. So I'm going to bring some muskie stuff and see if I can catch one in 5 days. So wish me luck. Give me 10 years of luck for that. 10-inch
fish. We may potentially be doing another muskie trip in the fall, just kind of like a weekend trip again. But
yeah,
that's that would most likely be like Crown Land camping on for some muskie waters and on some bigger water too. So hopefully we'll make that happen as well to kind of close off the year.
Yeah. So like most anglers that are listening to this podcast, you probably fish for a lot of different things. I know some people are like, I just fish for bass. Or I do this, but I would urge you, if you live in Ontario, there are over 250,000 lakes in Ontario. They're all full of fish. Not all of them, but a lot of them have fish in them. And there's lots of different kinds of fish. Do yourself a favor and try fishing a new lake this year. Do some research. Find a new lake. Go camping somewhere new. Go to hire a guide somewhere new. Do something new this year. You'd be surprised. Like, fishing is fun, but keep consistently learning. And try to do something, because you might do something like, sometimes we book a trip and it absolutely sucks. We're like, this lake sucks. We're never going back. Maybe it was just a bad time. We go back again. It sucks again. Like, okay, this lake sucks. We're never going back. But the odd time you'll find a lake and you're like, oh, I can't wait to go back. Me and Andrew are like, oh, we talk about, we always name our lakes different things. Like, oh, let's go back to Little Okeechobee, you know? Oh, I know. Yep. You know. So we always come up with code names for our lakes so that you guys don't know where they are. But yeah, I'm not going to tell you, but DM me and I won't tell you. But anyway, lots of trips, but I recommend try something new this year. You will not regret it. Here's another question. This is actually a very hard question. I don't even know if I want to answer this one because it's from Jay Matthew. He says, what is your favorite bait from all of the companies that sponsor the podcast? Ooh, I don't want to get into any fights here, but so we've had probably 25 giveaway sponsors over the last 2 years. It's really hard. And I actually had someone comment this on one of our posts. So they literally said, we were talking about jigs because we did a bunch of jig sponsors back in March, and we had Jacked Up Jigs, we had Choppy Water Bait Company, we had a bunch of other jigs, and I was like, dude, they all make fantastic jigs. Like, you just look at them, there's not a bad one in the bunch. All these guys are knocking it out of the park.
All of them.
Yeah. If you had to reach into a sack of jigs and not prick yourself and just pull one out, I almost guarantee you wouldn't be like, oh, dang it. Like, they're all beautiful. Like, like the two that like that just come to mind instantly for jigs, I'm like, wow, like Choppy Water Bait Co, his jigs, his swim jigs, amazing. And then Jacked Up Jigs, you look at his like bladed jigs and swim jigs, they're like works of art. They're amazing. So like, it's really hard to choose because everyone makes something different. But if I had to, he said, what's your favorite? So like, favorites are going to be different, but I have to say one of my favorite things that I sometimes, if you listen to this podcast, you'll know when we do a sponsored episode for someone, they'll send us a few baits to show off on the podcast. Usually a few baits. They're like, here, show these off. And, you know, obviously you get to keep them and fish them, which is great because as you can see, we have lots of baits here behind me on my pegboard wall. But one of the baits that I just looked at and I was like, oh, this is nice. It was when we did an episode last year with Jacked Up Jigs. Now, Sheldon makes really good stuff, but I pulled this spinner bait out of the box. Remember that black and orange one? And I was like, oh my goodness. It's just like a beautiful spinnerbait. It was black and orange with gold blades. And I'm like, dude, this is going to slay pike. Remember that one?
Yeah.
What's your favorite?
My favorite. Now, I personally haven't caught on it, but I really, really want to. I'm going to be throwing it a lot this year for muskie. And it's the Water Wolf Lures tube jigs. And those, like, we had him on, I forget when that was. That was a little while ago. Yep. We had some like bass magnet stuff and some Water Wolf lures, and Yeah, you got one right there. So those little tubes, Jesse's modified that one to put his little like blade in the back of it and stuff, which is awesome. I saw him catch on that.
Yeah, that was fantastic.
And, but yeah, like I have yet to catch a muskie on rubber. And one of my go-to rubber baits are going to be those tubes this year. So I think, again, I do have confidence with it because every guy I've ever talked to about musky stuff, all of them are like, fish the tubes. And like, and Water Wolf Lures, his tubes are legit.
I caught two of my biggest musky last year on this exact tube. And yeah, I modified the tail. I put a little blade on the back of this tube. And I remember fishing it. We were with our buddy Paul fishing one of these lakes, and I was just like jigging it beside the boat. I was like, Andrew, look at this tail. And there's like fluttering behind the bait. And he's like, oh, that looks sick. 2 minutes later, a muskie just like grabbed it beside the boat. Andrew saw the fish eat it. Yeah. And I looked down. I was like, oh, I just saw this fish like just clamp down on the tube. And I just like set the hook to the side. But I remember Andrew was like freaking out because he thought I was going to set the hook and pull it out of the thing's mouth. Because I just reacted, but thankfully the thing had two hooks in him. So,
the thing came up from the bottom, let's say like the bottom left, and Jesse just like sets the hook real hard to the right. Like, I'm like, you're just going to pull it out of his face. Set it back into the fish.
It's just my rod positioning was very weird. Yeah, and I was like, it was that hook set or nothing. Thankfully, those hooks that come on Water Wolf Lures are super sharp. So it's pretty good. I actually found that spinner bait from Jacked Up Jigs. That is an absolute gorgeous spinnerbait. Again, we're very picky with the brands that we deal with. And most of them are small shops, which we love supporting. Mm-hmm. They all make great stuff. Super nice stuff. Like, we wouldn't literally sponsor a company that makes trash. We're like, hey guys, check out this trash. No, they all make good stuff. We're very picky. So we got a few more questions here. Someone says, oh, another one about topwater. Man, everyone's thinking about topwater. Must be the snow outside. What's your favorite topwater lure? Mine, hands down, is the Whopper Plopper. So Andrew told you his favorite topwater lure. I'd have to say if I could only have one topwater lure, that's hard. But I'm a huge fan of the Whopper Plopper as well. And I wasn't for a long time because it was just like, it seemed too cliche. Like, everyone, oh, Whopper Plopper, you know, like, just seemed like an idiot bait. Bought a bunch of them. I've caught almost everything on those things. I've caught muskie on them, bass, smallmouth, largemouth. Doesn't matter. Like, anything smashes a Whopper Plopper. But I think for the most exciting lure, like I said, that one with the props, anything slow. But I really love fishing a popper, like Andrew said. Like, I love a walking popper, a popper that can be walked back and forth. I love just like, you know, target casting around logs or docks and just letting it sit there and just popping it side to side, and the bass comes up and blows up on it. Love that. Super fun. So here is a question from Matthew. He says, from one small boat guy to another, do you find yourself sacrificing gear and equipment so you're not over max weight?
Not really. Like, the amount of stuff you need to bring to be over your max weight in a boat,
it's pretty intense.
It's a lot. Like, I know my tinner can hold, I think it's like 550 pounds or something like that normally.
Yeah.
Which again is a fair bit of weight. Like, if I'm fishing and I have more than like 20, my tackle box as full as it is weighs maybe 20 pounds. And then my combos I have with me are like 20 pounds. Well, let's say I have like six combos with me. It's well under 20 pounds. So for under 40 pounds, you know, it's not a whole lot of weight. And there's not much else that goes in the boat when I'm fishing. You know, we go, even in the sports pal, we have, like, those guys hunt moose at a sports pal.
My sports pal has an 800 pound capacity.
Yeah.
So even with us,
and so 550 is after like I'm in the boat and the motor and all that stuff too.
Yeah. Yeah. So even in my boat, 800 total, but like both of us, let's just say that's 400 pounds plus the battery in the motor. That's an extra 100. Like, unless you're bringing hundreds of pounds of gear, you should be fine. Like, I know in some kayaks, the weight limits aren't as generous. So like, there's lots of kayaks where it's like, oh, you only get 300 pounds after you're in it. And if you have a battery and a trolling motor, it can add up pretty quickly. But for us, generally, because we both have slightly more capable boats, it hasn't been an issue for us.
Even in my canoe, though, like when we did that, it's a portaging canoe, and we had that thing loaded. But that thing is designed to run like really low in the water, too. But they can take a lot of weight, like a surprising amount of weight. And the gunnels, yeah, they're maybe only, you know, 3 inches above, 4 inches above the water. But you know, you paddle out to your site carefully, you unload it, and then you're good for the rest of the trip. So you have your trip out, maybe camping, loaded up for, you know, 5 nights or something like that. Yeah, your boat's going to be pretty full, but you don't have a choice. And you do things safely, make sure it's packed heavy stuff in the bottom and stuff like that. Like on a day trip or the day-to-day, once you're there on site, I'm never at risk for overloading my boat.
Yeah, like we've gone camping a few times where my sports pal is like literally strapped stuff in with bungees so it wouldn't fall out.
Cargo netting over top.
Yeah, and it was fine. It was totally fine. And we've been in some pretty sketchy waves too. So here's a question from Neil. He says, what are your opinions on rod sleeves? Do they actually do anything? So if you're... Yes and no. So if you're thinking of this, they always say like, oh, it's rod protection. They're not going to stop your rod from snapping in a car door. They're not going to do that.
Are you speaking from experience, Jesse?
I am. I broke two rods. I actually broke a rod in a rod sleeve as I put it in, which is great. But the main thing that is good about them, Andrew,
prevents tangles.
Tangles. Especially if you are someone that rigs up your rods before you go fishing so that you can just, you know, get to the lake and pull them out. It's also cool when you get to pull it off. Like, shing, it's like pulling out a sword. But we do really like them because we fish... I mean, we have a small boat or a sports pal, but we actually keep our rods in the car. And Andrew has a hatchback, I have a sedan, not a lot of space. So what we do is we get all of our rods, the reels on them and everything. The line, the lures, usually we don't leave the lures on so they don't like stab my, you know, my headrest and stuff like that. But everything's rigged up and we put the rod socks on the rods. And then we basically have these like straps that we strap all the rods together. And then we have these bungees that suspend off the back of the seat so that they just kind of like go between me and Andrew's head as we're driving. And then when you get to the spot, they just all come apart. No tangles whatsoever. The rods aren't smacking against each other when they're driving because that can cause damage too.
And some of these vibration the entire drive up.
So I would recommend, it isn't the best protection ever for a rod for transport or stuff, but it is, I definitely recommend them for just tangles and minor damages and scratches and stuff like that. Here's a one for Andrew. Jamie says, where do you source your leader making materials?
So I'll often go to, depending what it is. So sometimes I can find some really good like fluorocarbon on sale at some of the tackle shops. They may have this, you know, heavy duty leader stuff that's been sitting on the shelf for a long time to make sure it's not expired and, you know, old and super crackly or something, but you can use that. I know I was fortunate enough to get some like really good stuff like on sale. And so that's what I've been using my leaders. You get one big spool, it lasts you a long time. I did a lot of testing some cheap products like in bulk, and I had a lot of issues with them of, you know, things just coming apart. And I wanted to make sure, especially the leaders, making them, especially for a musky leader, you know, you finally hook into a musky, I don't want my snap to just disintegrate or crack or like they literally, some of them are breaking. When we were trying to put baits on and off, so I'm like, okay, I'm never using those again. So nowadays, I usually just buy my materials. Most of them, some I will get online because I found a couple of good sources. Just, you know, even Amazon, you can get the right source. Just look at the store it's coming from, make sure it's legit and not, you know, some hole in the wall kind of thing. But for the snaps, I get those like name brand because those are the things I was having the most issues with. So now I've been using the Ryugi snaps, and they're like for like the finesse leaders and stuff like that, or I'll use Spro or anything like name brand has like a double lock system on it, so it's nice and secure.
Yeah, and a lot of testing went in these, like I'm not saying like a lot of testing like a musky company, but like Andrew, he's been making leaders for probably the last like 2 years
and he went now,
yeah, and he's like, here, try these out, we use them, oh, I don't like this snap, or this snap broke, I'm trying to get it on the lure, it's not big enough.
Different crimps,
different techniques. He's got better at making them, and it's gotten to the point where like that's all I use, obviously, because, you know, he makes them for me for cheap. I'll just be like, Andrew, I need like 30 liters by tomorrow, and he's like, you get 3. But they're good. That's all we use now, and he has such a wide range. He can do custom, right? So like I'll say to him, like, I'm particular. I'm like, hey, I want, he makes these leaders that are my favorite. They're called the just in case leaders. It's a small, I think it's like a 50-pound fluorocarbon.
50-pound fluoro, yep.
It's 50-pound fluoro, and it's for use when you're bass fishing or you're walleye fishing. If you're using like a chatterbait. Now, again, this isn't like a good leader for finesse fishing, but like if I'm fishing a chatterbait, musky and pike will just bite those off. But if you're using 50-pound fluorocarbon, I'm not saying they can't bite through 50-pound fluorocarbon, but it really reduces that chance. In fact, I've yet to break one off using the 50. As long as you hook it and you know it's a muskie, just play it very gingerly and it generally will come in.
I'm not going to run. Last year, I was fishing, when I was targeting pike, I was purposefully using those 50-pound leaders. So I was only using just-in-case leaders while targeting for pike. And yeah. I didn't have a single one. I was catching multiple pike on these leaders. I felt completely confident. Like, yeah, their teeth were chafing against it, but it takes a lot of chafing for their teeth to get all the way through a 50-pound leader.
Yeah.
So
it's surprisingly tough.
It was, yeah. The reason why I started making them, why I wanted to start making leaders in the first place was because I like fishing topwaters, and I'm sick of getting my, you know, my frogs snapped off by pike or muskie.
Yeah.
But at the same time, if I go get a muskie leader or something like that, they're too long and they're too heavy now, and they have a huge terminal tackle on it, and it just sinks the thing. So all my action is gone, and it's, you know, sitting down, nose down in the water and whatnot. So with these small leaders, Jesse, like, I make some for Jesse. He wants something like 3 inches long of like the fluorocarbon, and then just a small like weld, like solid welded ring.
It's not that short. It's like 7 inches.
You did ask for a couple like 4-inch leaders though. I know, because I made them. But they, like, yeah, they can get like whatever size you want. But I, using those, there's even some where I don't even put on a solid welded ring in the back. I know some guys, they use a swivel ball bearing. I make those as well with real ball bearing swivels. But at the same time, you only need a swivel if you're fishing a spinner or a spoon. Otherwise, your bait isn't spinning through the water, so you don't need a swivel. So less weight is just to have one little ring. Less weight than that for when I'm fishing like finesse stuff, not BFS, but more finesse, like topwaters and whatnot. I use an Albright knot, and I tie directly from my main line right onto the leader. And I've tested like the knots and stuff, and that seems to be the best one to have a secure connection. And then again, you're eliminating something else. You're eliminating a whole copper crimp and a split ring, a solid weld ring on the back. So it's a little bit less weight that's going to be weighting down that, you know, finesse bait.
Yeah. And again, they work great. Like, we fish a lake that is full pike. I've lost more frogs in that lake than I care to admit. You'd be fishing for bass, you know, catch a bass, and all of a sudden, boom, this snot rocket shoots out. And it's not even a pike worth losing. It's like 12 inches long, and it snips your frog off. You're like, oh, there's $12 gone, right? So we started using these short. I don't think I've got 4-inch ones, but I've got some pretty short ones. Like, it's just long enough that a pike, even if a small pike engulfed it, most of the leader would be out of its mouth. Yeah.
And now you got the 4-inch ones for fishing jerk baits because you wanted a nice short one.
Yeah, but I haven't lost a fish on them. So anyway, if you're interested, Andrew does sell them. He does them all custom. So you can definitely message him on Instagram, or you can message us on Patreon. But here's another question. This is actually a good question. So this is from Will. You know, some questions though, you're like, that's a good question. Interesting. It's getting me thinking.
As if all the other ones aren't.
They were trash.
For shame, Jesse. For shame.
So Will asks us this question. He says, all these questions that I've been reading so far, the last few have been from Patreon. So thanks again for being a member. He says, is there ever a legitimate reason to play a fish on the line, or is it best practice just to get them into the net as soon as possible?
I'll say yes. There is, like, as much as possible, you want to get it in the net as soon as possible. There has to be like some leeway in that description, because when I'm fishing BFS and I'm using like super light wire hooks, and I hooked into that like 4.5-pound smallmouth, I played that thing for a bit because I can't horse it in, because I'm using 10-pound, you know, braid and these wired like light wire hooks. So like, yeah, if I cranked up my drag, those hooks would bend out and I'd lose that fish. So I had to play a little bit just to, you know, it's going to run, it's going to take it, but that's a powerful fish. I'm not going to play something just so that, oh, it's more tired when I get it in the boat. Like muskie, we get it in the net. Pike, we get it in the net as soon as we can. We'll leave it in the water on the side. We'll unhook it. It stays in the net. It's still in the water. It's fine if it's moving around and whatnot. If you can bring it up out of the water and it's hanging in the net, it starts thrashing, that's when it starts tearing its fins and whatnot. If it stays submerged in the water, though, it usually thrashes around less, and it's not damaging to the fish to do so either. But yeah, it's mainly it's if you don't want to bend your hook out, you got to play that fish a bit. You're muted, Jesse.
I was muted. So I think it has to do mostly with what you're fishing for. Cause like, obviously you said musky, you want to hook those things and get them in there as soon as possible. Like they're big, tough fish, but they can't handle an extended fight. Oftentimes you'll see them dead floating upside down in the summer. Cause it was too hot. Guys were catching them or fighting them too long. Sometimes on bass tackle, not their fault. You hook whatever you hook. Right. And then the fish will swim away, but they end up dying because they can't handle that, especially with the low oxygen. So it generally is better to fight. That's why everyone's like, oh, I use heavy musky gear. The musky in here aren't that big. It's like, because I don't want to fight them to death. It's an ethical thing. You hook a musky. Yes, I can catch a 40-inch musky on a medium heavy bass rod. No problem. I can get them in, but it takes longer. They could oftentimes die afterwards. So you want to use proper gear and kind of horse those fish in. But again, if you're float fishing for steelhead with 4-pound line, if you horse that fish in, you're going to have to retie your hook soon. So that's another thing. So that was our question and answer. Now we have to say special thanks to our Patreon members. We do really appreciate all the support that you guys give us every single month. You help us cover some of the expenses that come and occur from this weekly podcast. There are expenses, unfortunately. A lot of people are like, man, those guys just talking to a microwave we don't talk into a microwave. We talk into a microphone. They just talk into a microphone. That's pretty easy. It doesn't cost them any money. There are expenses, obviously. So we do appreciate all you guys and girls who donate a few bucks a month. And the extra money will buy Andrew half a cup of coffee so that he can, you know, get some of that in his mustache. We would also like to thank everyone who's recently written us a review. We really appreciate it. If you haven't written us a review yet, we would really, really appreciate you do so, because it helps us actually rank better in the podcast charts. It's great that you're listening to this episode, because that helps us as well. But if you want to be super awesome and the best person ever, said Andrew, if you leave us a review, especially on Apple, because you can type out a review, or on Spotify, you can give us a star rating. So we do appreciate that. And now we have to end this episode, as usual, the quote of the week. And to handle that, the man with the mustache, Andrew.
I always forget about these.
On the spot. I got an idea. I'll start off and you have to finish the quote.
Okay.
Make sure it rhymes. I'm not the best rhymer. That's why I'm making him do the rhyming at the end. If your lure's in a pike's mouth.
What do you rhyme with mouth? Make sure you catch him on the mouse.